it's been a long-standing structure here in the neighborhood. The gallery building over here was built in the 1920s, and along with several other outbuildings on the block, are part of the larger Milo Arts campus. We are celebrating the documentation of its 30-year anniversary with the exhibit that's on display. All of the photographs were taken by community members during 2018 and just documenting aspects of their daily life. The exhibit opened last weekend, and we have several of the resident artists here to speak with you all today. I'm also a resident myself and gallery director here. My name's Abigail, and then I will let our panel members introduce themselves. Oh, and Sadie is the one hiding under the table over here. This is Sammy. Sammy is in the wing. You will see her studio on part of the tour. She is a ceramicist, photographer, woodworker, etc.
Gardener.
Cook.
I guess. Yeah.
Wow.
And you have lived here since?
Since 2015.
Very good. And you'll see her photograph, part of the show, documenting her studio space as well. Then we have Tariq.
Hello. Hi. Hi everyone, welcome. My name is Tariq Terry. I am a photographer. I focus on forced migration and refugees across the globe. So I focus on the trauma that what caused the refugee, how they come here, U.S. policy, through all the photography and the narrative. I've been in and out of Milo since 2004. So I switched a couple of studios, and I walk him into my studio later on to see some of the work that I do, and walk him into a little space for me.
And Tariq's studio is 211. It's in the part of the building that was added in the 1920s, and will also be a stop on the tour today. And next we have Deb and Miss Bella.
Which is which?
Bella.
Which is which?
Which is which? Bella. Yeah, I know. yeah, my name is Deb Patron, and Dr. Deb Patron. I am a doctor. I'm a resident doctor. I don't keep hours. I'm a jack of all trades. Someone once told me that I've done so many things in my life, she thinks I should have been 105 years old, and that was close to 20 years ago, so God, I don't know. So anyhow, right now, I think I'm writing, at least I'm trying to write, and I teach at Ohio State. But I have a degree in painting, I dance, I study dance, and probably done too many things in my life too. I was just remembering how I sewed prototypes. I sewed stuffed animals for American Greetings when my daughter was little. I made teddy bears for their prototypes, for their toys. I've done lots of things. That's it.
Okay. Next we have Art Cat.
Yeah, I'm Art Cat Kramer. I'm a painter. I do representational work. I'm very pop work. I've been here at Milo since 2013. I was here for 2 years. I left for 2 years, went to Florida, come back because I love it here. I couldn't find a space as big as mine and that I could afford. I need space. I paint pretty big a lot of times. What else? I'm also staff here. Something breaks down, help take care of my fellow artists. About it. I guess I'm in 208, and you guys will see my studio in a little while. I'm in the same section of the building as these two.
We're neighbors.
Yeah. So that's it.
And we have Rick Borg at the end of the table.
Hi. I do a lot of paintings on wood, and I've been living here since 2011, and I work here too. So learned a lot of things as far as work, and it's nice to get along with all the people. And I helped with the gallery getting it going. I was the first show, so guess that's about it.
Rick's in Studio 122 at the end of the wing that was added in the 50s, which you'll see today on the tour as well. He's also painted many of the murals around the property, including on the side of the outbuilding there at the corner. You probably can't see it from this angle, but there's a fun elephant on the end cap of that building. So look out for the murals as we go around the property today. Again, my name is Abigail, and to start, I thought it would be a great intro to have everyone share how they first found out about Milo. Just some of your initial experiences when you first came to the building, what have you. I first lived here in the early 2000s. I had some friends from school who were artists who had found out about the building and were moving in, so I kind of tagged along with that. Milo was actually the first place that I ever lived when I moved out of my parents' house as a teenager, so it's been home to me for a long time. I have lived in other parts of the city, and then more recently with my involvement in the gallery, came back to be a resident of Milo Arts again. So as a few have mentioned, many of us have lived in multiple studios through the building or even lived here over different 10 years. So kind of a testament to how it has a unique connection and can draw people back to the community.
I found out about Milo from driving around the neighborhood. I'm not from Ohio, and I used to live on 2nd in Short North, and we were looking for a live workspace, so we found this building, and then I searched hashtags on the internet until I contacted a resident who contacted me with Rick. It was very hard, it took months, and it's not like that really anymore, so it's nice.
I guess in 2004, I was working on studio photography, and it's been so long, I don't even know how I found it, but I came here and I talked to Rick Mann, who some of you have met and will meet, and just from finding out from the building, what should have been a 20-minute conversation turned into a 3-day conversation. And I really fell in love with the place. Many of the people that are there in 04 may not be here, but at least the culture has grown into this one family, respect and love and caring for each other. So, and I stayed. I was gone for a couple of years, but I came back, and ever since I've been here. So, just to be clear, I don't live in the building, but I work out of the building for many hours. So some of us live here, some of us.
I heard about Milo from some people I knew, and one person who was living here, Brian Kellett, is a photographer. And I was interested for a while, and one day I called and there was something available, so it was fast for me. That's how weird it can be, the turnaround. And so I'm here. I've been here since, is it 2014?
My story's great. When I first came here, I was an empty nester. My daughter grew up. I wanted to give up the house. I had a nice house, and I just wanted to pursue the art. I used to have a light construction business. And when I came here, Milo still had the danger signs on the door, and the city was really coming down on Rick. And I came here for an interview to get into the place, and Rick Mann was more concerned about getting people in here to fix the last of the things on his list that needed to be fixed. So there had to be a bunch of mudding, drywall work to be done to block fire, stuff like that. And while I was here for my interview to move in, and Rick was talking about that, like, I can do that. I know how to do that stuff. He goes, do you know how to do electric? I've got some broken electric. I said, I could fix that too. It all had to be done like in 72 hours. So I came in, got it all done, fire department came in, passed, and Rick loved me from that day on. So that's what got me in here. I knew I'd be a fit. As soon as that happened and I saw that youth in Rick's eyes, Rick's got that burning look like, we can make this work, we can do this. I kind of latched on to that. I was like, yeah, I kind of had that craziness going on too. And I could be part of this. Here I am, 6 years later. So that's my story and I'm sticking to it.
I heard about it. Sam Hoare used to live here back in the late 80s, and he toured us through. I used to work with him. He lives here now. He just moved back in, but so I knew about it way back when, and I knew some other people lived here. So I was in and out of Milo over the years, just visiting, and then I lived over Larry's bar on campus for 27 and a half years, and nobody lived there that long. They sold the building, so I had to go. And then I stayed in another friend's house for a while, and then needed a place, and okay, I'll come here. And I thought maybe it'd be too many people knocking on the door or something, but it's worked out well. Rick toured me through the few that I thought was on my price list, and he said, well, there you go. It wasn't cleaned up or anything. It was a big mess. I said, okay, I guess that'll work. So, and I started working here pretty soon after that, because I was always a handyman and that sort of thing. And once you get started around here, there's endless work, sometimes too much. Because, you know, you want to do your art, but in general, it's pretty well balanced these days. So.
Thank you, Rick. The building has been through some ups and downs with city code, fire regulations, what have you. There's also been ebbs and flows among the wait list of residents. There's currently a pretty lengthy waiting list for prospective applicants who are interested in joining the community. I've had some random experiences, like Uber drivers dropping me off, like, where is this place? Do people really live here? So the facade, if you haven't been around past the front of the building, it very much looks like a castle. And there are elements of the building over time that have been under construction to different degrees, so it's a very unique look to it. I'll just kind of open it to the floor. Anyone who might have an interesting anecdote of an encounter of someone for the first time seeing Milo Arts, and if they were, surprised, confused, pleasantly surprised, what have you.
There's one thing I do want to make clear. We do have, we can live here and work here. We're totally legal to do that. When I think it was called the Ghost Ship, when that place burned down, people automatically start saying, well, that's going to happen to Milo. But we have the fire department come in, we get inspections. We have a great fire suppression system. It's a little too much. I mean, it goes off for nothing at times. We get everything inspected.
Sandwich.
Everything is inspected, and we do everything with permits. We're here, and we're here to stay now. The city can't kick us out. But we can use money for that roof.
Yeah.
Besides that, everything's pretty cool.
Very good point.
Thank you. But also, when we do have tours, I have a lot of people who come in here who've gone to school here. You know, and they tell me about the teachers. When I used to be in 202, it was Mr. Durfee, and he was really nice. And 205, that was Mrs. Gabriel, and she was really mean. People tell me crazy. You know, so that's cool.
Surprised that it was an arts community. I just didn't know what it was. So even in the neighborhood, people who live on the street. So I guess it fits in on the most part.
I think for me, car break-ins, a lot of things that are nature that, you know, you can leave your windows, you know, sometimes. I feel like that has went down.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So the safety of the neighborhood, the cleanliness, I feel like the artists here and the residents have brought into a lot of accountability and cleaning up the neighborhood. So it's totally different.
first year it was like that. It was still pretty rough. Now it's the neighborhood's really nice and quiet.
Yeah.
For the most part, it's kind of unusual how quiet it is now. It's been, tremendous.
Thanks.
That grew up, died.
And that does kind of bring me to the next prompt, that the building did operate as a school into the 1970s. So there are many residents who, if not themselves, have family members who attended school who are still here in the area. So that's a very special connection we have to the community. Over the years, there's been many various events and community engagement opportunities, from residents doing artwork classes with children to having fairs in the lawn. Also, as was mentioned, we participate in neighborhood litter cleanups, things of that nature. And within the community, we also have our own community service aspect, or just ways that we're able to connect by nature of the shared living environment. As a talking point, just maybe, some unique involvement that you've had with the Milo neighborhood or within the arts community that you maybe hadn't thought you would experience prior to living here. My example, there's a gymnasium on the other side of the school building that was added in the 50s. And the gymnasium, now most of the floor has been polished down, the concrete is smooth, and so we've uniquely utilized it as a roller skating rink for a couple parties and fundraiser events. So roller skating in the old Milo school gym was a really unique way to connect with everyone and bring people together, and not something I anticipated I would ever do in my living place.
We had parties there, music, people coming out, debuting new music. Kinds of parties. It's nice. People do different things here. Like, I do more maintenance here, where some of us do more liaison work in the neighborhood, or work with getting bands in here or promoting the place. So all of us do different things, and sometimes it all interchanges too. You know, we run pretty smooth sometimes. Surprising. We're a bunch of artists. We do.
I'd like to speak to the community at large, the Milo Broken. I'm peripherally involved with the commission and other commission meetings. There's something about this area that is very community-based, and it seems like it has been from the beginning when people settled it before Columbus absorbed Milo and Brogan, these two separate little towns. And I was shocked last month when I said the commissioners were talking. We're concerned about gentrification, with all this stuff is coming in, and it just moves from Italian Short North to Italian Village. And frankly, we feel that we can coexist, rich and poor, and we're working on that. There's no one in the cities that's going to take me away. But anyhow, no, I'm just kidding. I was shocked at the last meeting that the commissioners knew each other.
I believe the highway was put in the 50s and divided the neighborhood at that point. There's this side of Milo is referred to the west, and then there's an additional east portion of the neighborhood as well. Tammy on the spot. She is our resident organizer of our community.
Sore thumb more, or you feel a little like an oddball. Whereas here, I can be outside painting or being an artist, and I fit right in. I don't have to worry about that. So that, in that sense, it's taken a little, eased my mind a bit. I feel more at ease, and it's easy to run into people, have friends, whereas you might not connect with people so easily. Another apartment, like apartment building I used to live in, we rarely were that good of friends. You know, you see each other, but you know, you didn't have that in common of being an artist in the same community. So it gives you a head start on getting along with people. And so, yeah, and there's a lot of freedom here. It's, you know, it's a studio. You don't have to worry about getting paint on things, and so and the whole showing thing, and I can put artwork in the hallways to look at it, and that's really helpful. So that's part of it, and then working too is a nice balance between, you know, I don't like just sitting and painting all the time. It's just nice, healthy balance. So that's about it.
To art at all. And then you've got your family who is completely different. You have to be a parent or husband or wife or what have you. But Milo's a space in which to provide that creativity push, if you may. And I think that's what it does for me, and definitely what Arcad pointed out is you walk around and you look at a painting. How did you do this? What style were you going for? And it's like you're going to college. Your art history is right in front of you. Everybody will share with you how they did it, or why they were feeling the way they did it. And you get inspired every day, and then you start producing your own style of work. And also, from an artist to an artist, it's like I need something. It may not even be art related. A tool or something. I could just knock on somebody's door and I could just get it. As long as I return it. Sometimes I don't return things. So that's my little confession there.
Another all-nighter. And we did. And Rick hardly worked. He hardly slept for 2 days. He actually went in and laid down on the floor and fell asleep for 20 minutes. I was up on the scaffolding going, you know, I'm starting to see things. I'm losing my balance. I gotta go. I was dawn the next morning. I said, I'm quitting. I can't even think straight. I couldn't do anything right anyway. So.
Yeah, Rick was like, I don't know if we're gonna make it through this. I'm like, oh my God, if you don't think we can make it through it, then last night we did it.
This was another time, but yeah, that the time up there, the time up there in in gyms. They went well into the morning.
That's how we roll here at Milo.
Luckily, we haven't had to do that for a good while.
Yeah, I think all those days are over.
I hope.
Knock on wood.
Yeah.
And so if anyone else has questions about what life is like inside the artist community, or any aspect of the photography in the exhibit, what have you.
Just come up too later on and ask all the questions you'd like about the arts.
So we'll take a break here, and then right around 3 o'clock, it's about 2:30 now, we'll gather up into small groups for the tour portion where we'll go through the building. If you haven't already checked in at the table toward the side doors, we do have name tags and a check-in list up there. Photos in the exhibit are all for sale, and much of the artwork that you'll see on display in the hallways in Milo is for sale as well, so please feel free to inquire if you're interested in anything. We do have some bottled water available, at the stand under the tent. Following the tour, we'll have additional refreshments when we come back here. And there are restrooms on the left. And feel free to grab any of us and ask any questions here in the meantime.